This is just an introduction of mine. So, hello everyone. In this lecture series, I am going to talk about the drugs in obstetrics and gynecology, and I am going to cover all the drugs which are commonly used in the obstetrics and the gynecology. So, coming first to the antihypertensive drugs in this lecture. Okay, so this is a magnesium sulfate. It comes in the ampoule, and you need to have this in your labor room, in your emergency department, in cases whenever you get a eclampsia or preeclampsia, right? So please have this in your emergency tray. And important thing here I want to show in this injection is this part. Can you see? This is written 50% weight by volume. So there are different preparations coming, and you need to know what do you mean by 50% weight by volume. That means it is a 2 ml ampoule and contain how much? This is, you see, this is a 2 ml ampoule. Right? So 50% weight by volume, that means 2 ml is containing 1 gram of magnesium sulfate. Remember that this is a very common mistake when you are telling in the exam that this is in milligrams. No, this is in gram. This is the drug which is there in the grams. So 2 ml contains 1 milligram, that makes a 50% weight by volume, right? We have a 20% weight by volume also. So in those cases, when you have to give a loading dose, you have to double the number of ampoules. So after taking all these things, let's talk of some amount of mode of action. And during pregnancy, as an injectable form, it acts as an anticonvulsant, antihypertensive, as well as neuroprotective. We will talk of those doses in the coming slides. So coming to the anticonvulsant action, just to tell you, it was a 80-year-old drug around, and it was a MAGPIE trial in which MAGPIE, M-A-G-P-I-E. Anybody can ask you? MAGPIE. So magnesium sulfate in the prevention of eclampsia. This was the trial done in a multicentric trial done in various countries, and it has been shown that there is a 50% reduction in chances, reduction in the occurrence of the eclampsia and eclampsia whenever this drug is used. So this drug has become a boon for the patients of severe preeclampsia, so as to prevent a development of the eclampsia, as well as it is used in the eclampsia also for the prevention of the for the treatment of the fits. So it is a drug of first choice, and everybody should be having it in the emergency. So I'll just erase this. Okay, so how does it act as an anticonvulsant action? So if you see, it blocks the NMDA receptors, limiting the action of the glutamate and other neurotransmitters. You can see here, so it binds to these NMDA receptors. It binds to these NMDA receptors and prevents the action of the glutamate and the other neurotransmitters, so as to prevent neuromuscular activity and prevention of the fits. In hypertensive crisis, there occurs a disruption of the blood-brain barrier, and it directly acts on the brain parenchyma to prevent the extra neuromuscular activity. How does it act? As if, although there is a very less hypertensive action, but still there is some amount of antihypertensive action. And how does it act? It blocks the calcium from entering into the vascular smooth muscle and decreases the intracellular calcium activity. Also, there occurs an inactivation of the calmodulin-dependent kinase activity and decrease in the contraction. So this is the way it acts as an antihypertensive.
So hello everyone, in this lecture I am going to tell you regarding the specimens in obstetrics and gynecology, and this first lecture will be on the obs specimen, and I will be talking on the most commonly shown specimen to you during your table vivas. So whenever any specimen is shown to you,
so hello everyone, in this lecture I am going to tell you regarding the partogram. Although partogram gradually become obsolete and it will be taken by a labor care guide which has been given recently in December 2020, which I had already explained, but you must be knowing the age-old technique of recording the labor progress with the help of a partogram. So now it is very important to know what are the instruments needed for the IUCD insertion. So we need sensor speculum, we need uterine sound. Nowadays IUCDs are coming which have got a plastic uterine sound also, which is sterilized, and this is a Valsalum, or you can have a Alis forceps, Alis tissue forceps also. And this is the scissor to cut the thread 1.5 to 2 cm from the os, and this is a sponge holder for the cleaning. This is a device, and this is the betadine for cleaning. You always have to take a full aseptic precaution, and these are the few gauze pieces to clean it. Another important thing is when to insert this IUCD. So this IUCD insertion can be done immediately after the delivery of the placenta, that is called as post placental IUCD insertion, and for that technique is totally different. Then you can insert within 48 hours, that is called as postpartum IUCD insertion. The technique for that is also different, and these instruments are needed for the interval IUCD insertion. You can do it within first 5 days of the menstrual cycle, or you can do it anytime if the patient is coming for a needing for an emergency contraception, then also it can be inserted within 5 days of unprotected intercourse, right? So this is a very important question, and immediately after MTP this can be inserted. So Dr. C. Bravado is a systematic approach towards the CTG reading. So these are the terms. DR is taken together. C, DR is determined risk. C is for contraction. Baseline rate, that is baseline fetal heart rate, variability, acceleration, deceleration, and the overall impression of the. So now coming to these interpolation of this physiological findings in this CTG. So whenever you are seeing this CTG, you have to first see the how much long is your CTG. For that matter, you have to see the speed of the machine. There are three speed on which this machine can be set: 1 cm, 2 cm, and 3 cm. We generally use 1 cm per minute, so that minimum paper is being used and our eyes are set on that ECG, CTG findings only. So remember that we are setting it at 1 cm, few of the countries are setting it 2 cm or 3 cm per minute, right? If you see it is a 1 cm per minute, that means. So this is all about the prostaglandins, and in the next lecture we will be taking further on the drugs used in obs and gyne. So if you want to prepare your clinical viva, you can take a course on mechanism of labor, and where 5 video lectures are there. You can take a surgical instruments, 10 video lectures, and you can take a quick exam revision of table viva. It will be very beneficial if you take these three along with the long and short clinical cases, where 24 discussion are there, which will be helpful for all of you to prepare for the examination. Thank you.